Hey guys, thanks so much for listening. If you'd like to support us, please go to patreon.com/Frightday.
Where did the
EMF detectors go? Sam, did you still not fucking find those?
I still have not looked for those.
Okay, will you please find them?
All right.
It is Frightday. This is episode 63. I'm your host, Byron. And tonight, we discover the true, nagging, messy definition of forever, reviewing Ben and Chris Blaine's Nina Forever. And Kelly details... What? Kelly details crystal clear evidence that she's an alien hybrid?
You bet.
In this week's edition of Kelly's Cryptids and Conspiracies, are we serious?
Of course we're serious.
I'm joined tonight by Kelly.
Hey, guys.
And Sam.
Hey, guys.
Kelly, people have been asking. Last week you teased something a bit spookernatural.
I don't know how much I really want to talk about that story because it actually scares me a lot. Okay, I'll tell you.
Okay.
So.
Twist her arm.
It was about 10 days ago now, 4 in the morning, and I sleep like a rock. It's a great skill I have. I'm a very good sleeper.
A rock.
For some reason, I wake up at 4 in the morning, which I don't do. This is weird. My eyes are wide open, and I'm staring at the door to our bedroom. And so in our bedroom, I sleep on the right-hand side of the bed. Sam sleeps on the left-hand side of the bed. The right-hand side of the bed is closest to the door. Still a ways, though, because we've got this, like, sitting area thing.
You have a large house.
We have a large bedroom.
Sure.
I don't know that we have a large house. We have a large bedroom.
All right.
So
our house is fucking gigantic.
Not gigantic.
So much money.
Yeah. The bedroom, there's space between my side of the bed and the door.
In the cash stack.
No.
Are you sure?
Oh God, yes, I'm quite sure.
All right.
If it was, then I would be interviewing Alexander Skarsgård in a few weeks, you fucker.
I apologize.
So I'm looking at the door and literally... the whole door opens and then no creaking. That was maybe the weirdest part about it because a lot of the doors in our house do creak.
Sure.
No creaking. Silent. Opens all the way. Like 100% open door.
Fully open.
Yeah. And so I'm freaking out. I wake Sam up and Sam's like, oh, whatever. You probably just didn't close it all the way last night. I'm like, okay, if I didn't close it all the way last night, why would it wait from 11 until 4 in the morning?
You skipped the approach.
Oh, I was freaked out. I was like, Sam, the door just freaking opened by itself. I wasn't screaming. I was just like, Sam, the door just freaking opened all by itself. And he's like,
the door opened. We can agree with that.
And he's like, you probably just didn't close all the way last night.
It's
and
I'm cool like, voice, Sam.
And I'm like, Sam.
I talk like that.
It's his morning voice.
It's his That's 4
that sexy
voice.
Morning voice.
I'm like, Sam, if I hadn't closed it, it would have opened at 11 when we went to bed. It wouldn't have like waited randomly until 4. And I should add to this story, we had our house assessed for how tight it was in terms of heating because we had really astronomical heating bills for a while there. So we had the power company come out and they do like this free assessment to see, oh, where are some leaks that you can patch up, blah, blah, blah. And they're like, actually, your house is so airtight, it's bad.
It's
like,
dangerous
it's
because it
dangerous.
The gas is built
yeah.
up.
So ACA, there was no fucking draft, okay?
Sure.
Dispelling that possibility immediately. Sam's like, oh, it's probably just
stop,
draft.
Stop
and I'm like, Sam, there's no draft. And he goes, oh, it's probably just pressure changing in
Can
the
you
house.
Can wake up at some point during this conversation? Like,
no.
Fully? Okay.
And I'm like, Sam, pressure changing in the house. We aren't a fucking airplane. We aren't
I don't
like.
Wake up because I don't fucking care.
So in other words, there was absolutely no solution to what happened. Got up, closed the door. Super scary. But here's the interesting part about it, I guess. So the idea of it scares the hell out of me. It made me very nervous and it was very surprising. But this is, again, something Sam's going to laugh at. I always hear from people who believe in this sort of stuff and who have had extensive experiences that you should pay really close attention to how you feel. Like, do you feel genuinely threatened or in danger or unsettled? Or is it just really surprising and weird, but you don't feel necessarily in danger?
Good ghost, bad ghost.
Right, exactly. And I have to say that at the end of this, so like whatever 15 minutes where I'm trying to get Sam to have some kind of a reasonable discussion with me, finally give up and he rolls over and goes to sleep and I decide I'm going to have to just probably fuck up and go to sleep. I realize as I'm laying there, I'm like, you know, it's really weird because I'm a huge scaredy pants.
Okay.
And there wasn't any point in this whole ordeal where I felt genuinely unsafe. Like it freaked me out because it was like, whoa, but it wasn't, oh my God, something horrible is going to happen. It never felt dangerous. So I guess I'm trying to cling really desperately to that feeling that there wasn't something horrible, but that, you know, there may have been something going on, but hopefully it was not.
That's kind of spooky. Especially spooky. The missing EMF monitor. That's kind of weird.
It is weird. It's weirding me out, actually, quite a bit.
Well, it's definitely around here somewhere. Things don't ever disappear. The laws of physics
not true.
Forbid it.
Another fun story for you about disappearing things. First 9 months that Sam and I were dating. He was living in a town about 2.5 hours from here, and we were doing the semi-long distance
gig. Not convenient.
No, it wasn't, but it was fine. Whatever. I drove over there one weekend, and Sam, being a single 20-something male, had nothing of any healthful value in his house to consume. And I decided if I'm going to invest some energy in this guy, he better start eating something decent so I get some years out of him at least. So I went grocery shopping.
You're thinking this already?
Yeah. So I went grocery shopping, and I bought him some really healthy, good food. And one of the things I bought him was this pork loin, okay? Like this really yummy pork loin.
This is the haunted pork loin story.
Yep.
All right.
Unloaded all the groceries, put them in the cupboards and the refrigerator. Never again was that pork loin seen. We have no idea where it went. Disappeared. Just like the EMF detectors.
Is this like that Berenstain time rift, it never existed thing?
Yeah, the Mandela effect.
There you go, the Mandela effect.
Yeah, I don't know who would have input a memory for me of a pork loin that didn't exist.
That's probably the pork loin you saw in the store but didn't purchase, but...
No, I purchased it. Sam, you verify this story.
It was a long time ago.
Really? We discussed this pork loin all the goddamn time. Are you kidding me?
It's a funny joke.
As much as I'd like to talk about pork loins all night, I say we start ripping through what we watched this week.
That sounds good to me.
Okay. I thought you were going to say start ripping through loin cloths. I don't know. I thought you were going somewhere all with the loin thing.
That's a funny bit.
Sam, what did we watch? Anyway, we watched that new James Franco
11/22/63.
Oh my God. I've been meaning to watch that. That Hulu original
series.
It's actually pretty fun.
It's rad.
It's really fun.
J. Brums and Stephen
Franco.
But no.
Mostly just Franco.
Okay. He has nothing to do other than.
And that other
acting,
guy,
right?
The good actor from Adaptation. What's his name?
Nicolas Cage?
No. Chris Cooper.
Oh, Chris Cooper. Okay.
I went right to Nick Cage also.
Thanks, buddy.
No.
How is it?
Really good. It's really fun.
I don't know anything other than it has something to do with bugs and JFK assassination.
What does it have to do with bugs?
In the commercial, there's a bunch of cockroaches crawling on stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Maybe they're
not there yet.
Yeah, I think it's just an effect thing.
Is it basically just a retelling of the JFK assassination?
No.
Kind of hoping it would be more because that would be a fun conspiracy. But no,
it's great. It's about this guy who,
James Franco,
who travels back in time on a mission to prevent the assassination of JFK and along the way takes the time to try to right other wrongs.
That's exciting. I think I need to start it. I haven't had much free time.
Only 2 episodes out. You're fine.
Too deep right now? They didn't drop them all at once?
No, I thought they were going to, but they didn't. Only 2 out.
Huh. I did watch a little bit of something.
What?
The commentary track to the Blair Witch Project in preparation for a podcast I'm doing in Seattle this week.
That really interests me because that movie was so original for its time and they made such great use of the resources they had. I bet there were a lot of good stories that came out of it.
There were. And I feel like I didn't know that much about the Blair Witch Project going into this little talk that they had. It was directors Daniel Myrick, Eduardo Sanchez, and the producers Rob Coey, Greg Hale, and Mike Minello. Apparently, the actors didn't really know everything that was going to be happening. They told them kind of things that they needed to do, and when they needed to get a shot, they let them in on it. But for the most part, they had no idea what was going to happen next.
The production crew was just out fucking with the actors, basically.
Yeah, while they were sleeping in the tents or like making noises, they placed little recordings of noises places that, like, as they sleep, that would like surround them, recordings of like children, things like that. It was really interesting. It makes me wonder why found footage directors don't do this kind of thing more often. I know it's kind of risky because you never know the product you're going to get in the end. But if it's anything close to the Blair Witch Project, then it's a masterpiece.
Yeah, and you get aspiring actors that are too afraid to call the the Actors Guild to report the working conditions.
I can't imagine who they could get now. Because, I mean, even Josh Leonard, he's probably the most famous person out of this project. I read something like he got paid $500 initially for his role in this.
Which is not worth it. I mean, at the time.
Yeah, I don't think I would spend 6 days in the woods with one power bar and one apple. That's what they were provided every day for their allotted amount of food intake.
No deal.
It just shows a lot on the screen, like the desperation that they have and the exhaustion really comes through. I highly recommend this commentary track. The cool thing is I think it was recorded like in 1999, the commentary track. So a lot of things.
Fresh.
Yeah, a lot of things are still new. They're talking about one of the songs in the soundtrack that was recorded. They were talking about how the band's website was cool and they had MP3 downloads.
The Stone Age of 1999. The only website I remember checking out with any regularity in my high school days was the Blair Witch Project website leading up to the release. Pretty sparse, if I remember correctly.
I feel like it's still up. I should check.
This movie definitely scared me more than anything I'd ever seen up till that point.
Yeah, I'm excited to talk
cried
about
in
it.
The theater.
You cried in the theater?
Curled up in a ball on the floor of the theater by the last scene and was actually crying.
On the floor?
On the floor of the theater.
That's gross.
I was so scared. I was like hyperventilating scared.
And you were into horror at this point, right?
I mean, yeah, I've always been into horror. I've just always been also very affected by horror.
A quick little thing I found out in this commentary. You know the scene where Heather's crying into the camera?
Sure
the,
do.
The big famous...
Yeah.
It was improv.
It was improv.
Her nose is running like mine is right now.
She actually thought while she was filming it that her whole face was in the frame. So it's just like a happy accident that it's that weird like cropped corner.
Huh.
Very interesting stuff. I don't that's listen awesome. To enough commentaries. And I mean, that's one of the reasons I buy physical media is to have these sort of special features. But I don't have the time to do it for the most part.
Yeah.
Hopefully I'll get more time to do that. I thought this was a really interesting use of time.
Uh-huh.
Did you guys watch anything else?
The Battery, which was really fun. Kind of embarrassed we hadn't seen it before that.
In kind of, I guess, celebration of Ohana Films' Kickstarter to get Tex Montana released.
They did it.
They did it.
Congratulations, boys.
Yeah.
Popping
nice
champagne
work.
Sound effect yeah. right now. Maybe yeah. a noisemaker or two.
So we supported that Kickstarter effort and watched The Battery, their previous film, to kind of immerse ourselves in that world. And it was one of the best zombie films I've ever seen. I think it ranks up there with George Romero's best.
Ah, oh, man.
It did such an amazing job of casting the characters, these two friends, on a road trip as the important part of this movie. And the zombies are kind of incidental, and it's about relationships and humanity and inhumanity. It was just really, really well done. And I loved it. Can't recommend The Battery enough.
Agreed.
I'm so happy for Jeremy and Christian and Adam. This is really great. And it's one step closer to a sequel to The Battery.
Yeah.
Kelly?
Yes. I'm here.
You seem a bit exhausted.
I'm a little tired. It's just been, I'm kind of like you. It's been a long week, but I'm good.
It seems like you've been up for nights.
Yeah.
You got a bunch of little band-aids on your arms?
Yeah, I've been taking lots of blood samples.
Why are you doing this?
Not really. I don't have to take any blood samples. I know what I am. And we don't know what you are, though. You're a big fat mystery.
Fat?
I didn't mean it
so
like that.
So weird that your mom didn't know your blood type.
That was rude.
I didn't mean that.
In this week's edition of Kelly's Cryptids and Conspiracy.
Kelly's Cryptids and Conspiracies.
Hey, guys. Who's ready for a science lesson?
Didn't sign up for that.
In all sincerity, the first part of this is going to be very, very scientific.
So skip forward how far?
No. It's important that you okay. understand the foundational science behind it before we go any further.
Fancy music.
Quick pop quiz, Byron.
Mm. Okay.
What does it mean to have Rh negative blood?
It means, I don't know, I'm sorry.
So everybody has a blood type, right? A, B, O.
Maybe.
A, B. I happen to be A.
Okay.
Byron doesn't know what he is.
Don't know. Neither does my mom. It's concerning.
Sam's B.
B.
Sam and I are also both negative. So you know how people always say they're O negative, O positive, B negative, B positive, whatever. So we're both negs.
Is that like the game? Neil Strauss?
Yeah.
Do you peacock?
What?
Do you peacock?
Do I peacock?
I'll fill you in later.
Okay. So what Rh describes is whether or not you have this protein on the surface of your red blood cells. If you don't have the protein, you're considered Rh negative. If you do, you're considered Rh positive. The vast majority of people are Rh positive. It's actually named for the rhesus monkey. It's one of the things that helps us understand that we are actually descendants from primates. This is all
you
true.
You have to say this as a theory, right?
No. Everything, I'm going to move to theory. And when I move to theory, I will say that.
I mean,
at this point, this is all science. Okay.
But what about?
So for African Americans.
I'm no monkey.
African American. Oh, God. No, I'm not doing that.
I ain't no monkey.
African Americans are about 90 to 95% Rh positive. Asians are 98 to 99% Rh positive. And depending on which figures you use worldwide, it's only between 5 and 15% of people who are Rh negative around the world. Okay. So in other words, Rh negatives are rare. There are some statistically measured common traits to Rh negative people. And I'm not indicating causation or correlation. Actually, no, I am indicating correlation. I'm not indicating causation. They may be one because of the other. I don't know. But these are correlations. Very predominantly Caucasian. They tend to have higher IQs. They tend to have lower blood pressures. They tend to have lower body temperatures. Those are things that are established and measured. All right. Where this becomes a big deal and why many females know whether they're negative or positive is because when you are of childbearing age, you can get into a situation where if you are Rh negative, it can increase the risk of miscarriage in certain cases. Rh negative women with an Rh positive partner are at risk of spontaneous miscarriage and other different rejection events involving your pregnancy because your body has the possibility of rejecting the baby if the baby has a different blood type than you. If the baby has that protein on its red blood cells and you don't, your body's going to detect it as a foreign entity and may do something about it. So
discarding.
It's more complicated than that. But what is very, very interesting about this is if you have an Rh negative partner, like my husband, we know we're going to have an Rh negative baby.
Well, that's exciting.
Well, it is. It's interesting. This is the only instance other than one other species where, so Sam and I and me and any other Rh positive person are obviously the same species. We should be able to breed without any problem, right?
Sure.
And that's the way it is in the animal kingdom. We are the only species with one exception that becomes a problem with. And the only other species where that's an issue where there
reptilians.
Are reptilians. No. Mules. And you want to know why? Because mules are hybrids.
Gross. What?
Mules are hybrids.
Oh, I see where you're going here.
Okay. The same issue can arise with mules. But mules and humans are the only two places that this Rh negative, Rh positive factor can arise where it can actually reject a baby and make it impossible for two people to breed.
So wait a second. If mules are hybrids and this affects them, does that mean that humans are hybrids?
Oh, it sure could mean that. It sure could. So one more bit of science before we go any further.
Okay.
The Rh negative factor is considered a genetic mutation. According to science, it is of unknown origin. And the closest they can tell it happened. Oops, sorry.
Oh, that's just water on your computer. You're fine. Maybe just on the top.
Also, well, as near as they can tell, it happened between 25 and 35,000 years ago. Originally, it spread heavily into an area that is now Spain, England, and Ireland. All right, so that's kind of the extent of like the established absolute fact. Now, clearly, what we're going to do is move in a little bit to what some of the theories are behind why the heck Rh negative even exists, because clearly it's an issue. People believe that the Basque people.
I've heard that before during the Mel's Hole episode.
Oh, it was because the Basques, Mel went down and that's where the little guy came out of the well. Yeah.
Yeah.
The little seal guy.
Come on. He had no top hat. That's fabrication.
Yeah.
Okay. So the Basques of France and Spain, there are many people who believe that that is where point zero was. Right now, that's the highest concentration of Rh negative blood type. The other interesting thing about the Basque language is it also is of unknown origin and cannot be placed within any standard classification. We're not really sure where their language came from.
Huh.
Typically, anthropologists are able to trace back many characteristics of a civilization. They haven't been able to figure out where theirs came from. There's this scholar at the University of Iowa. who suggests that the Basques were far advanced in terms of their navigational skills and other aspects of technology, basically long before the rise of the Roman Empire. Sam, pay attention to this.
I'm listening. Long before the rise of the Roman Empire.
Okay, good. The Basques, this researcher believes, are the last remnants of the megalith builders. These are people that left behind standing stones. Does that sound familiar to anybody? Perhaps.
No.
Stonehenge.
Okay.
Other rock structures all across Europe and even in Eastern North America. Two facts set the Basques apart from other Europeans. Like I said, their language is completely different. And two, they have the highest recorded level of Rh negative blood. So basically, their instance of it is about twice that of other Europeans. Significantly higher.
But that's still pretty low, right? It was between 5 and 10% or? Well,
but 5 and 15. But in with the Basque people that still live there today, it's closer to 40%.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. So it's pretty crazy. Probable technological feats of the Basques include Stonehenge, a unique system of measurement based on the number 7 instead of 10, 12, or 60. Regular visits to North America long before Columbus, to fish, to trade for beaver skins. And actually, they recently unearthed some British customs records that show large Basque imports of beaver pelts in the 1300s, which is long before we understood people to be coming over here. So that's kind of cool. They also invented a sophisticated navigational device, which was actually called an abacus, but is not related to the common abacus. All right, there was another report on population genetics that was prepared in the 90s, sent to UNESCO, and I actually found this on the National Center for Biotechnology Information website. It's a government website.
Dork.
I know, I am a dork. So here's a question from the report. Are the Basques genetically different from other Europeans? Again, we're talking science here, folks. Answer. Apparently, yes. It has long been known that the Basques have the highest proportion of rhesus negative blood in Europe and one of the highest percentages of type O blood. Recently, however, the geneticist Cavalli Starza has completed a gene map of the peoples of Europe and finds that the Basques are strikingly different from their neighbors. The genetic boundary between the Basques and non-Basques is a very sharp one on the Spanish side. On the French side, the boundary is a bit more diffuse. It shades off gradually toward Garonne in the north. I probably pronounced that wrong.
You're doing your best.
Sorry. No, I am.
You're doing your best.
These findings are entirely in agreement with what we know of the history of the language. Next question. Does this mean the Basques are directly descended from the earliest known human inhabitants of Europe, the Cro-Magnon people who occupied Western Europe around 35,000 years ago? Answer. Nobody knows. This is possible, but we have no real evidence either way. The only evidence we have is negative. The archaeologists can find no evidence for any sudden change in population in the area for thousands of years before the arrival of the Celts and later the Romans in the first millennium BC. The people of the Basque region have a greater than 50% concentration of the Rh negative gene. The frequency decreases in relation to the distance from the Basque region into the rest of the world. This genetic mapping helps to show that a mutation from Rh positive to Rh negative occurred quickly somewhere around the Basque area of Europe between 35 and 40,000 years ago. We don't know why and we don't know how, but it definitely leaves some really interesting questions open. So even though the Basques look Caucasian and definitely would be considered white, they have these distinct genetic differences that don't allow their actual genetic makeup to be classified as part of the quote-unquote white race. Since they're possibly the originators of the Rh negative blood factor, they also have a different shape to their bone joints, the cranial bones in particular, which they have something that is actually called reptilian skull ridge.
So my joke was kind of right?
Yeah.
Ooh.
Apparently, they also have a slightly thicker breastbone. Interesting. Hmm. So there's some of these like slight differences, right? So where the hell did they come from?
I mean, where did we all come from, man?
Okay, well, I mean, we're not getting into that.
These are good questions.
Sam.
Yes.
Are you familiar with the Nephilim?
The Nephilim are the master race of possibly angels?
Mm-hmm. Tell me more.
You guys are a match made in heaven.
I don't know. Honestly, everything I know about it is from metal.
My God, I love it. Okay, so there is a biblical tale that talks about these Nephilim. Basically, they're these angels, these creatures from the sky that fall in love with humans and come down and breed with them. It's in the Bible.
Really?
Yeah.
In the...
Yeah. And the offspring are then called Nephilim. These people are described as pale, closely compared to Caucasian. Some other interesting characteristics. I talked about the scientific characteristics.
Wait, what do Nephilims do? Do they have any abilities?
Oh, sorry. So the Nephilim, you know, people talk about ancient aliens and all of these things in the Bible and in other religious texts that seem to indicate a presence of aliens throughout our human history. The Nephilim is a very good example of that. So in the book of Genesis and in the book of Enoch, which is my favorite book, even though it never made it in, because Enoch, Nucky from Boardwalk, that's what he's named after.
Really?
Yeah. So God gets really pissed off.
That's why it didn't make it in?
Well, basically, it was supposedly contained too much idolatry. In the book of Enoch and the book of Genesis, which everybody's much more familiar with, clearly, God is pretty pissed off about the sexual coupling between these celestial and terrestrial beings. And so he begins to move in on an act of terrible judgment. Quote, "And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth." Genesis 6:7. Yeah. Basically, Enoch was supposed to give this message to deliver to Noah, telling him that the whole earth was going to be destroyed, and he was supposed to instruct Noah in the way of escape. We all know that story. But the reason the earth was going to be destroyed was because God was real pissed off about the angels coming down and getting it on with the humans, creating these Nephilim.
That makes sense.
The story that is kind of the most famous biblical story is the story of Lamech, found in the Genesis Apocryphon. So basically, it talks about how Lamech had been away from his home on a long journey. He comes back and discovers that his wife, Bat Enosh.
Fun name.
Yep.
Beautiful name.
Beautiful name. The daughter of Enosh has given birth to a baby while he's been gone. And he's pretty damn sure that this baby ain't his.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Call up Povich.
Yeah. Call up Povich.
Call up Povich.
Yeah. Unfortunately, no Povich in the time of Lamech and Bat Enosh.
I could have swore there was a book of Povich.
I think there wasn't. But maybe. The child bore no resemblance to him or anyone else in the family. Apparently, the child was extremely beautiful when he opened his eyes, quote unquote, lit up the whole house.
Cyclops.
Mm-hmm. "I have begotten a strange son," said Lamech. "His nature is different and he is not like us. And his eyes are as the rays of the sun and his countenance is glorious. And it seems that he is not sprung from me, but from the angels." So this is one of the cases where God's like, okay, enough.
We'll take
him back. Can't have this anymore. But it's kind of creepy because the way that the wife describes the story, she swears she hasn't cheated on him. So yeah, I mean, a couple more quotes. "The sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and took them wives, all of which they chose. They bear children to them, and the same became mighty of old." So
what does that mean?
Yeah, it's the Bible. Essentially, they had offspring that were half God, half children.
Okay.
The Nephilim.
Sure.
Yep.
But this flood killed them.
Well, that was supposedly the purpose of the flood.
But
we still have Rh negative blood.
Noah, a.k.a. Professor Charles Xavier.
Yeah, could be. Uh-huh. Was it? Maybe.
Maybe.
Hmm. So
makes sense to me.
There's another story that is very much in the same vein, but that kind of connects in the same way. So there's also a theory of the Anunnaki, which basically sounds very, very similar to the Nephilim. However, the Anunnaki in this story would have been the gods, quote unquote, that came down. The story goes along that back in ancient Sumerian times, there was this highly advanced alien race that came from somewhere else in the cosmos. They basically built and bred and created the first human societies. The thought is that these ancient beings, they planted some seeds, they genetically altered primitive human species, they created stronger, more adequate beings. But the Anunnaki's legacy, quote unquote, would have been the Rh negative gene that they left.
Which benefits our body temperatures.
You bring up a point.
It's kind of a flaw.
No, not necessarily. I mean, it's like 1 point on average. But before...
So it's insignificant.
No, but I mean, think about in terms of global warming. A degree is a lot, right? What's interesting is there really is no scientific explanation for this. And a lot of the theories that are out there are pretty damn crazy. But the point is there's some weird aberration that happens. So there's something very, very, very strange. We can't really define what it is. The theories, however, are pretty freaking interesting. Some of the perhaps less scientifically proven characteristics of people with Rh negative blood we're now going to go into. Increased occurrence of psychic and intuitive abilities, hypervision and hyper other senses, hypersensitivity to EM and ELF fields.
And some antimony claws.
higher negative ion shielding, predominantly green or hazel eyes.
I thought you were going to say skin like the Hulk.
We cannot be cloned. Increased sensitivity to heat and sunlight, much higher incidence of alien abduction and other unexplained phenomena. Okay, so okay. Let's just back up for a second. You're sitting at the table with two Rh negative folks. Forget him because he denies everything. Okay. Let's go through the list.
I think it was a threat.
Lower blood pressure. I have like almost dangerously low blood pressure.
Yeah, I remember when you were pregnant and you couldn't move.
Oh, really. Yeah.
You were having some troubles.
Yeah, lower body temperature.
You're a bit chilly.
But not only am I cold all the time, but literally my body temperature runs cold. Like my doctor has it on my charts that I have a lower than normal body temperature. So when they take my temperature when I go to the doctor, they don't ever worry that it's low because that's just like normal for me.
But that's also just a normal part of having low blood pressure as well.
Okay, fine. High sensitivity to sound and smell and sight. Sam, how yes. annoyed do you get with the frequency that I say, what was that noise? Do you smell that?
Well, but I'm annoyed at everything you do.
Right. But like I am obviously my sense of smell and my sense of hearing are pretty freaking hyper.
Okay.
Off the charts.
We get it.
So they're okay? Your superpowers.
I have a scar on the back of my leg and had annoying. Nightmares
wait,
about
wait,
being.
Wait. What's this scar?
I have a scar on the back of my leg. Nobody can explain where it came from. It's a surgical scar. And I had nightmares about being abducted my entire childhood.
You just said a bunch of stuff about blood pressure, and then you're cooking right through the
okay,
surgical
well, I'm just saying,
scar.
There's a higher instance of alien abduction and other unexplained phenomena, okay?
So you fully believe that you've been abducted by an alien?
No, I think it's a possibility. I don't fully believe anything.
Do you have any memories that come back?
No. I mean, I have memories of, literally, I have this recurring memory and a recurring dream of the, like, classic gray alien face at the window in my bedroom, which could just as easily be explained by, like, walking into my parents watching Fire in the Sky as it could be by something actually happening to me. But my point is, clearly, I have an interest in all this stuff, too, right?
Sure, yeah.
So that's another thing. There is apparently a much higher attraction to the study of very strange paranormal fringe things for people with Rh negative blood.
Your leg x-rayed?
I mean, I'm sure I have at some point. I've had so many damn x-rays.
Let's get it.
Okay.
I'm going to dig through that.
Sure. We can do that.
I think we should throw that leg up on the table.
Dig through that.
Nope.
Yeah, move the mics and the mixer out of the way.
Nope. Okay, so higher than average IQ. This is not something I do. This is not something that I do. But I did, because of health issues that I had, I actually had to have an IQ test a few years ago so that they could determine whether I was having some type of a brain deteriorative issue. It came back with a pretty high IQ.
All right.
I am obviously very sensitive to EMF fields because I constantly think that we have a ghost in our house. I have green eyes.
That's nice. Yeah, I didn't even notice.
They're hazel.
I fucking hate you. I have green eyes.
Okay, your hazel eyes are green.
Oh my gosh. So it's pretty weird. I mean, it's kind of strange. That whole list legit applies to me pretty much.
Interesting. Okay. Yeah. But?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, you know, there are some interesting skeptic points that are raised. One of them is the Rh protein plays a significant role as a channel for CO2 gas across cell membranes in the body. Because of that, some people theorize that the reason that the Rh negative blood developed was so that people could exist at higher altitudes because it would help them be able to function.
Like in the Basque region.
Right. It becomes easier to breathe air in more northerly European latitudes without the Rh factor. It could have been a natural evolutionary tendency. Now, my counterpoint to that would be, well, yeah, but it could have been just as easy that the aliens planned it that way because they were planting seeds in this specific area. So they're like, oh, we got to make sure.
They don't want to make a super soldier. They want to make like a...
just a human.
Just like a better than.
Yeah.
Slightly.
Moderately excellent.
And it is important to note that Rh negative literally means the absence of something. So it's not like we have some alien thing present in our blood. It's something that is present in normal human descendant from primate blood is missing in our blood. There are many, many, many explanations for where this could come from. But because it affects, it's a small percentage of the human population. The vast majority are Rh positive. However, there certainly are enough people who are Rh negative that it seems like they would have solved this by now. Like, what the hell is the root of this?
Well, you can't solve a blood type. You're acting like
something's
wrong.
No, but like, I mean solve in the sense of what's the origin?
The mystery.
Yeah. Like, why haven't they been able to figure this out? It just seems very, very, very strange.
What do you think it is?
Do I think that aliens or angels fell in love with humans and came down and did us and created me? I mean, maybe. I feel like I'm part angel.
All right.
Yeah, absolutely.
You do have that cool angel tattoo on your bicep.
No, it's not on her bicep. It's on her lower back.
Mm. Oh, don't make fun of our listeners who have tattoos on their lower back.
Speaking
There's no
of
shame.
Tattoos on a back. Later in the show.
Yeah, later in the show. Yeah, you guys can talk about boobs for the next half hour. What I am saying is this. There is something very interesting and unique about Rh negative folk. It is of great interest to me to hear from anyone who is Rh negative to see if any of these qualities sound familiar to them.
Are you doing active research?
Yeah, I actually am, because this is really, really, really interesting to me. The craziest theory out there that I came across is that literally all Rh negative people are actually alien hybrids. That part I actually might be able to believe. I know that sounds terrifying, but yeah. Here's the kicker. Reptilians are tracking those with Rh negative factor blood. Going back into time, the Rh negative hybrids came from the Draco Caverns in the Carpathian Mountains. They were mostly red-haired with green eyes and black-haired with brown eyes.
Gross.
They tried to infiltrate themselves into the blonde, brown-haired population. That's how we have all come to be a big old mix of negative, positive shamalam. But our little family clan here, quite by accident, we're breeding some pretty pure blood Rh negatives.
Hmm.
You're not planning anything, are you?
Well, you never know. I mean,
I'm not really much of a planner.
For the people who believe in ancient aliens, you know, if you're going to listen to that guy with a really, really awesome hair, this is a theory that basically goes very much in line with what they're talking about. That if we were planted here, if we were seeded here, part of the beings that were seeded very specifically with Rh negative blood, and that we are a very separate lineage from those who have Rh positive blood.
In the words of the great Robert Zombie, more human than human.
Ooh, interesting.
Which is actually from what? Blade Runner.
What?
Really?
Yeah, that song's about Blade Runner.
I've never seen Blade Runner. Now I'm embarrassed.
Now you need to watch
you
Blade Runner.
You should be embarrassed.
Oh my God.
You should be embarrassed.
And actually, it's less human than human because something missing. Sorry.
Mm. I just want to leave everyone with the thought that much in the same way there is a British royal family with a very distinct lineage and they're pretty specific about it, but really they're going to kill themselves off because they're all hemophiliacs, so Rh negative people may soon be taking over the world. I don't really know. I mean, if we've got possible reptilian ties, if we've got possible other alien ties, if we can survive at higher heights as the oxygen supplies run lower, we may be better off. You better get that blood type checked, Byron. We need to see if we need to, you know, perform some genetic altering surgeries or if you're good to go as a neg already.
Kelly, the angel queen.
Yeah.
Thank you for that report.
Just to clarify, I really don't think that I'm any better than an Rh positive person. Right. But it is really fun to think about. Maybe sure. This is why I think that I've been abducted. Maybe this is why I love aliens so much. And maybe this is why I wear a Loch Ness Monster necklace every day. I mean, maybe it's all back to my Rh negative blood.
Report.
And if we can get serious for a minute about mental illness.
Hey now, you're so very welcome, Byron. I just really do want to hear from our listeners how many of them are Rh negative, because this whole theory that people who are Rh negative are more interested in these like offbeat topics, it'd just be interesting to find out if that is a more common thing, like are more than 10% of our listeners Rh negative. If so, maybe there's something to that, you know?
Kelly at Frightday.com, at Kelly Frightening on Twitter.
Hit me.
Blood, huh?
So much blood.
It runs through our bodies.
It does.
And sometimes it comes up from inside of our mattresses.
I hope not. That seems like the worst.
Well, I hope not as well. Me too. I don't know. Real sleepy. Watch the We watched a movie called Nina Forever. What do you say we talk about it?
Let's do that.
You're enjoying your visit here this evening. Now, on with the show.
Nina Forever
It's a 2015 British horror dark comedy written and directed by brothers Ben and Chris Blaine. Sam, could you tell us what this movie's about?
After his girlfriend Nina dies in a car crash, Rob unsuccessfully attempts suicide. As he begins to overcome his grief, he falls in love with a coworker, Holly. Their relationship is complicated when Nina, unable to find rest in the afterlife, comes back to life to sarcastically torment them whenever they have sex.
Weird movie.
Yeah.
And I like weird movies. This one, just for some reason.
Rubbing your face.
Okay. The movie was shot very well.
Beautiful.
The acting was pretty damn good.
Absolutely.
Way too many boobs.
Sam.
Just the right amount for Sam and Byron.
Probably
apparently.
Just fine.
I didn't notice.
Yeah, of course you didn't. Oh my God. The thing that was interesting to me is I love weird movies. I mean, you're talking to somebody.
Weird
who-
boobies?
You definitely said weird boobies.
I said movies.
I heard boobies.
I'm glad it wasn't just me.
I said movies.
Sure.
You guys are really out of control.
Okay. Talk about weird boobies.
I love weird movies. I love David Lynch, you know? I like Eraserhead, for the love of God.
But this, I mean, you're leading them in the wrong direction.
But my point is, I like weird movies. This was weird, but it wasn't my kind of weird.
Okay. That's understandable.
It just felt very dissonant at all times, but not in a planned way. I don't know. It also very, very well could have been over my head. I mean, there could be things that should have resonated because if I were more artistic, they would. But
I think it was just one extended metaphor. I don't think it was much more than that.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah, maybe then.
Basically about baggage we carry in the form of grief and old relationships and too much shit in our house.
So we mentioned that every time that Holly and what's the gentleman's name? Ben?
Ben.
Robert?
Rob. It's Rob.
Rob?
Yes.
Every time they have sex, Nina comes back.
Yeah.
In a rather stunning way.
Just
naked and bloody in the bed while they're having sex.
Broken.
Honestly, those scenes, they're pretty cool. Undeniably.
Actually, I disagree. The first one was cool because it was like weird. And then I was like, oh my God, we've seen it. Like half the movie was that. And it got so old.
But it was well executed. It looked good.
Well, it was well executed, but it's
that they
like,
took their time.
It reminded me of a Saturday Night Live skit that just ran like 10 minutes too long.
This is the post-weekend update of a film?
Yeah, it's like, okay, yes, we get it. And that was cool. Do something else now.
I see. I think it served its purpose in that we were supposed to be as
frustrated.
Yeah, as frustrated with the situation as Holly was.
I guess.
You know, it's not a bad situation and it keeps happening.
God, could you imagine if your ex crawled back out of the bed, or your, you know, pick a random ex, crawled out of the bed dripping gore?
Do you have a dead ex?
I got a couple.
I do want to point out that while this movie wasn't necessarily my jam, Sam, I want to make sure you understand that if I ever depart this earth before you,
unnecessary,
that will be me.
You're going to crawl out of a bed?
The difference being Holly would have her throat slit.
Whoa, chill. Holly's not that bad.
She's very nice. I liked her. I didn't like the dead girlfriend. I thought the dead girlfriend was an annoying batch.
But that's kind of the point.
I liked Holly.
The point
I'm just
is
pointing
that
out, Sam, that I would be the dead girlfriend, but much meaner.
If you remove Nina. And that's aggressive of you, by the way, Sam.
It's fine.
Don't feel too. I can't. Oh, I just don't want you to be sad.
I'm so bummed now that she wouldn't want me to be happy.
I would want you to be happy. You'd have to be happy with your memory of me.
So remove Nina and just replace her with the grief and the emotional baggage. And we have basically a romantic drama. And that's kind of what this is. It just has some rather bizarre and grotesque accompaniment.
I would not consider this horror at all. There are some gruesome scenes, but I don't think that in and of itself makes it horror.
And it's supernatural, which is something that Kelly always argues is necessary in a horror film.
There was nothing scary about this, though.
That's the number one. It has to invoke fear.
Yeah, and I don't know that was the intent.
No,
this is a drama.
It was also the sexiest film that I've seen with you two.
It was a bit corny.
It was an erotic film.
It was a bit porny.
Maybe a little bit too porny. I don't.
Yeah, I felt like it wasn't quite sure what it wanted to be, and I wasn't quite sure what it wanted to be, but I was pretty sure that I was overwatching it before it was over. Yeah.
Overwatching.
It had elements of Life After Beth.
Yeah, but Life After Beth was funny and
sure.
It was witty.
And cute.
And this is supposed to be funny.
I mean, it really wasn't that funny.
It's called a black comedy, but I don't know if that's just an excuse to do some surreal things.
Yeah, maybe, because there were points that I thought were funny, but I thought Life After Beth was funny.
Well, that was a straight up comedy.
This wasn't that.
I know you started off by saying it looked great, and I'm going to agree with you. I thought the cinematography was really great, and this is the directorial feature length debut of the Blaine brothers. And I think they're very talented. I just don't know if... What if this was a short?
What if this was a short?
Yeah.
I think I would have liked it way more. Yeah. It could have been a good short.
Ooh, it could have even been like an ABCs of Death short.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Yeah, no spoilers, right?
No, I think we should go ahead and give our numbers on this one. I think that I was not the audience for this movie, and I'm not going to penalize it for that because I think it was really well done. It just wasn't a horror movie. Too long for me. Technically, it was extremely well done. The writing was great. I definitely think that the Blaine brothers are headed for great things. I'm going to give this movie a 5.0.
Yeah. So there was nothing wrong with the movie. And it's funny because like I think about in terms of Rotten Tomatoes, would I give it like a rotten or not? Like, do I think it's worth seeing? Is if I'm going to do a straight thumbs up or thumbs down, I would give it a thumbs up. But it just, especially because we've been seeing so many incredible movies recently, coming on the tail end of The Witch, this is a tough one. I mean, that's a tough act to follow.
Sure.
Both because that one genuinely scared me and because it held my interest really, really tightly for the whole film. This one, I found myself checking my watch a few too many times. I felt like you probably summarized it best. This would have been an excellent short. If this had been done as a short, I probably would have given it like an 8. As it was, I'd give it about a 5.2.
And I think I'm going to... Oh, man. I unplugged my headphones.
Oh, no. Why'd you do that?
That's why I couldn't hear you.
Give me one sec. And I'm back. I'm going to go ahead and echo what you guys said. This is technically a good movie, but it wasn't for me. And I'm usually a pretty patient viewer. I lean towards these mumblecore romantic films where not much happens and it focuses on realism. And if you subtract the bizarre stuff, that's kind of what you have in this movie. But it has just too many laundry scenes.
Yeah.
And it's kind of exhausting the amount of emotion that they want to pull out of you but don't find. It's a bold first effort, and I do see some big things in the future for the Blaine brothers, but I'm going to have to give it a 4.9.
Yeah.
And that's our review of Nina Forever.
You guys, we got to stop agreeing on things.
That was really
tight.
We're
going to have to watch like either an alien movie or a torture porn just to get
something
us split up a little bit.
Somebody hates.
Maybe we're just really good pals, okay?
Can we watch an alien movie next
buddies.
Week? Can we please watch an alien movie? I really want to watch an alien movie.
I'll see what
aliens!
We have.
Jill. Aliens! Shh.
And if you've seen Nina Forever, let us know your thoughts at Frightday on Twitter or contact at Frightday.com or just leave your thoughts in the show notes of this episode at Frightday.com.
Mm-hmm.
And if you do like our show and want to help us make it even better, what can people do? They can go to shop.frightday.com.
Yeah, especially they can buy some awesome Kelly's Cryptids and Conspiracies gear. They could also go to our Patreon page. And if they donated even $1 a month, they would get access to the first and subsequent episodes of Kelly's Cryptids and Conspiracies.
Okay. You skipped
Captain Kelly's.
Shouldn't have reminded you.
No.
Yep.
No.
Captain Kelly's spinoff show.
We're there too, you know.
Yeah, I know. You guys are fine.
Byron and Sam put in an appearance, just in case you're concerned about that.
Patreon.com/Frightday.
And then one of the easiest things that you guys can do, which means so much to us and helps us more than you'll ever know, go to iTunes and leave us a review.
That's the best way to move us up in those charts.
Yeah.
Get us in front of more eyes.
Super helpful.
And I'm putting a killer Spotify playlist together for anyone that donates $3 or more a month.
Sam's Jams, patreon.com/Frightday.
It's going to be good.
Don't want to miss that.
Yeah.
What are we watching next week?
TB Diggity.
You don't know yet.
To be determined. Yeah. Well, we've got some contenders. We need to have some debate about it. I do think we need to have something that's at least slightly more polarizing. We need to get things a little bit feisty in here.
Home invasion, then.
I mean, sure.
Like that time that I took all your gym clothes to Goodwill.
Oh my God. Yeah, Sam literally trying to get ready to go to work and go to the gym in the morning. Uh-huh. Find out that Sam has donated all of my gym clothes to Goodwill, including my gym shoes.
Well, you said to take the basket to Goodwill. I didn't realize you meant just the basket.
This is a nightmare.
It's a great story.
Where can I find you on the internet, Kelly?
You can find me at Kelly Frightday on Twitter, or you can email me, Kelly@Frightday.com.
How about you, Sam?
I'm at Sam Frightday. Email sam@frightday.com.
And I'm at Byron McKoy. Byron@frightday.com is my email address. And until next Frightday, I'm Byron.
I'm Sam.
No.
And I'm Byron.
No!
I love weird movies. I love weird movies. I love weird movies. 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 Movies.